Welcome to this edition of CBN News Sunday. I'm Caitlin Burke. This week, public schools, their influence on students, and the influence Christians can have on them. We begin with the example of how things are changing, with a story out of Knoxville, Tennessee, where the University of Tennessee asked students and faculty to begin using so-called gender-neutral pronouns in the belief that it will create a more inclusive campus. The UT Office for Diversity and Inclusion claims the language alleviates a heavy burden for people expressing different genders or identities, according to TV station WATE. Another story tells of Scholastic, the education and children's publishing giant, coming out with a book about a transgender fourth grader. This book is written for third to seventh graders. Behind these stories, is there an agenda? The latest in America's culture war being played out on college campuses and in the classroom. Joining me now is Peter Sprigg with the Family Research Council. Peter, first off, your response to these stories.
Certainly, there is an agenda behind both of these stories, and that agenda is to deconstruct the reality that that human beings are born male and female, that we are created that way at the outset, and that those are immutable characteristics. But this is really the climax of a series of sort of waves of attacks upon the reality of the sexes, upon gender roles through the radical feminist movement, upon sexual roles through the homosexual movement, and now upon the reality of our sexual identity itself through the transgender movement.
How should Christians respond?
Well, Christians need to understand that God does not make mistakes in terms of how He created us, that our biological makeup is the most the most realistic indicator of whether we are male or female, and that in the vast majority of people, all of the indicators of biological sex are unambiguous at birth. We do not have a right to try to change the sex that we had from the moment of our birth.
Regarding the gender neutrality, why does gender identity matter?
Well, in a sense, I think it doesn't matter. I think we should accept that we are the biological sex that we were born with and function within that kind of context. What this represents is an effort to say, no, our sex is not determined by nature, or our gender is not determined by nature. It is something that can be self-created, and in fact, we can be whatever we choose to be. There are, of course, there are a lot of possibilities of what people can become, but changing their sex is not one of them.
Why do you think Scholastic decided to write this book, and is it something a third grader can even begin to understand?
This is what I think is very troubling, is that this is only going to create confusion in the minds of young people who might read a book like this or be exposed to this kind of agenda, particularly young elementary school age children. It's challenging enough for normal children to navigate and come to terms with their gender identity, what it means to be male or female, to come to terms with their sexuality in terms of their body and how it differs from the other sex and how it may change as they approach puberty and so forth. Things like this are only going to create greater confusion, add greater confusion onto the struggles that even in the ordinary course of things most children will have. First of all, most children may not ever be exposed to someone who is transgender because this is a very tiny percentage of the population. It may plant ideas, though, in the minds of those who are struggling in some way. And this is completely unnecessary because what the research shows is, first of all, most children who struggle with gender identity issues actually have those issues resolved before adulthood and do not change their gender identity from their biological sex at birth. The other thing is that those who do have a very deep-rooted struggle can be treated in childhood in a way that will help them overcome those gender identity issues. Simply affirming them as being the opposite of their biological sex is not the only solution, not even the most compassionate solution for them.
How can we turn the tide of this culture war?
I think we have to, first we have to speak out, we have to be bold and speak the truth, even when it costs us, even when it costs us the approval and affirmation of the more liberal dominated institutions in our society, such as the schools, maybe the teachers, the principal, and particularly our colleges and universities. We have to affirm natural law, the reality that there are givens of nature, which we as Christians believe are gifts of God, which are immutable and cannot be changed.
Being on the front lines, what are you seeing happen that might encourage believers in Christ?
Well, I mean, we are seeing people stand up and face the reality, and particularly in the wake of the Supreme Court's decision on redefining marriage. We're seeing a lot of Christians coming under threat. We're seeing religious liberty coming under threat. But we're also seeing Christians unite and stand up to try to defend their religious liberty, defend the truth of natural law and of divine revelation as God has given it to us.
Peter Sprigg from the Family Research Council, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Coming up, the body of Christ has a mission field right outside of the door of their church. Learn ways you can help and influence your public schools when we come back. Most churches have various outreach programs, from feeding the hungry out of their own kitchens to adopting villages around the world, and everything in between. So when it comes to making a difference in your public schools, what can you do? Joining us now is Sue Fitzgerald. She's the Vice President of Wave City Care, the outreach arm of Wave Church in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Sue, thanks for being here with us.
Thank you for inviting me.
So first of all, tell us about Wave City Care and why it's such an important part of your church.
Well, Wave City Care, as you mentioned, is the local outreach for Wave Church. And we're actually a separate nonprofit. And our pastors, Pastor Steve and Sharon Kelly, believe the local church is the hope of the world. And so if we're the hope of the world, we have to be out in the world. And that's what we're doing, whether it's through feeding programs, tutoring, mentoring, addiction recovery. We're out there. Pastor Steve has often said, if your doors shut tomorrow as a church, would your community notice? And we think they would with us.
Now, part of your outreach is the public schools. Tell us what you do there.
We do lots in the schools. It's really the majority of our outreach. We do big events like our makeover, school makeovers. We go into a variety of schools and we do landscaping, painting, cleaning, whatever the school wants. We also do a lot of mentoring programs. We mentor homeless and at-risk youth. We have a girls program, Shine Girl, which is personal development, and boys called Manpower. So we're in there with the youth. We do tutoring programs, partnering with the city. We do bringing in food for the kids who might not have it on the weekend. And really, it's not just us. It's Wave Women, our women's program. They'll collect food for these kids, or they'll make cookies and cupcakes and make them for every single teacher in the school with a personal note. So it's whatever we can do to just reach out to the schools and tell them they're important.
Now, how do you carry out your relationship with the schools?
It varies a little bit. When we started, it was through, hey, we know a teacher here, or let's go meet that principal. But really, we work through the partnership coordinator, whether it's in Virginia Beach or Norfolk. And each school has a partnership coordinator. So those are the people we talk to, and those are the people we interface to find out their needs.
How do you see school leaders and students reacting to what you're doing there?
quite frankly, they love it. They want us in there. They love what we're doing. They give us a lot of press, a lot of positive feedback. And the kids love the programs and want to see more of it.
How would you encourage other churches to approach the ministry in public schools?
I would just say, look around you. Find either the nearest school or if there's a teacher in your church or a principal and approach them, or find out if there's a system-wide partnership coordinator and go to that person and just say, I want to help. And I think you'll find they have open arms.
Do you often mentor other churches who want to start having this kind of ministry?
Well, WAVE Church has a big conference, WAVE Conference every year, and we do have sessions in that where we help people who want to get started in the schools, in the community, or if people who call us and ask for help.
The website is wavecitycare.com, and you can go there to learn more. Sue, thanks for all you do.
Thank you very much.
Up next, perspective from a former teacher on how to go about navigating the culture war in the classroom. As we mentioned earlier, different groups are wanting their beliefs and agendas taught or recognized in public schools. Joining me now to discuss the war of worldviews in the classroom is CBN News producer Rebecca Kemp. She was a teacher before changing careers and becoming a journalist. Rebecca, first of all, when it comes to the public school, you can't expect them to have a Christian worldview. Right. So what can you expect?
Well, as a teacher, like you said before, I was a teacher before becoming a producer, and I can say that the majority of teachers that I came into contact with do have the best interests out for your students, for your kids. They really want what's best for the student. And so teachers and school board members aren't getting into the public school system to ruin your children's lives. They really do want what's best for them. So what you can expect is, yes, there's different worldviews out there, but the schools are really out to love and educate your children. And that's really what's important, is for parents to realize that and want to work with the teachers and the school board members on all curriculum decisions and what's going on in the classroom. Parents can volunteer. They can get involved with what's going on in the classroom on a day-to-day basis. And they can also go to annual school board meetings, or some have multiple school board meetings throughout the year, and they're open to the public, a lot of them. So that's, you know, parents can get involved, and educators really do welcome that.
What about hot topics like the Fairfax County school decision to teach transgender sex education in their middle school, taking it from family education to health class?
Okay, well, there's a lot of stuff going on about the Fairfax County. So a lot going on, a lot of confusion. First of all, I think, you know, it hasn't really been transferred into the health classes yet. That might be on the horizon. But with family life education, parents can opt their students out of the classes. But yes, transgender is being taught. It will be taught. And a lot of things that parents might want to opt their kids out of will be in there. But I actually printed out the list of what the Fairfax County School Board posted in order to help parents understand what's going on here. And they said that topics added to the health standards of learning include personal development, emotions, feelings, self-image, self-concept, personal characteristics, skills to work, healthy relationships, and respecting individual differences and mental health areas. And these topics have been a part of the family life education curriculum for a while, and now they're in health, and those topics can't be opted out of. In there, there's no mention of transgender education. However, I mean, when you look at things like respecting individual differences and mental health areas, that might come up. And if it comes up, it's in a classroom that a student might be in that maybe they weren't supposed to talk about it. But like I said, that's a possibility, but it's not something that parents can't at this point. Transgender curriculum is not something that parents can't opt their students out of right now.
What do you think Christian teachers and parents especially should look at public schools as a mission field where they can make a huge difference to an entire generation?
Well, I definitely agree with you there. I think that they should be, as Christians, we are out on the front lines everywhere, whether you're an auto mechanic or a waitress or a teacher, you are on the front lines, and especially in the public school system. I mean, these students, they're growing up, and I mean, I saw someone's first day of school and they had the class of 2028 coming up, and I'm thinking, wow, in 2028, what's the world going to be like? These students are going to be our leaders someday. And definitely, you know, a lot of parents decide to pull their kids out of the public school system because they maybe want their moral compass to decide what their kids are going to be learning, and I don't blame them, because, you know, when you're in public school, the federal the federal education department, they decide what the moral compass is, and so you don't have control over that. And so, you've got all these students growing up with a certain amount of morality that's taught to them by their public school. And so what is that morality going to be? What is our 2028 year going to look like? What are our leaders going to look like? So when you have parents on the front lines with their kids, absolutely be God's hands and feet to the world, and love your teachers, love your school board. Let's not let this be cause for fear or cause for anxiety. Let's really get in there and find out what's going on. What is your student, what is your child learning in the school system? And how can you become a part of it to make it just a better environment for your child?
Now, when you were teaching, did you see Christian parents who saw the public schools as a place to be salt and light? If so, what did they do right, or what do you wish that they did?
Yes, I did. I was an English as a second language student, and so I saw, I was in 8 different schools, so even though I taught for a short amount of time, I had experience in lots of different schools, and I did see how students who had involved parents, they just thrived. And being salt and light, you know, there was a lot of instances where the parents would get involved. And sometimes you would have like a mom who would be like the adopted mom of the classroom, and she would come in once a week to help the teachers. And I have to say that teachers love that because they are so overwhelmed with all the work and all of the things they have to do, all the regulations they have to meet. There's so many things they have to do. And having the extra help, I mean, that's just love right there. And coming from a Christian person, I mean, it shows that Jesus really does care. God cares about what's going on in the school system. And that's just the best way to show a personal love.
Finally, what would you say to encourage teachers, parents, and students in public school?
Well, to encourage, like I said earlier, I really think it's important to not be afraid. The Bible says there's nothing new under the sun. Things like this have been around for a while. And even though in our lifetime, maybe we're seeing some new things that we haven't seen before, and it might strike fear into our hearts, but that's not what we're called to do as Christians. We're not called to be afraid or to rant and rave in anger. And yes, there's a time for righteous anger, but right now, I think it's a time to show love and to work with our teachers and our school boards and to get really involved, like I said. And I think, just cover it in prayer and cover your schools in prayer. If you have a child that's in the public school system and you're a Christian, I'm sure you're praying a whole lot. And I mean, even private schools, I mean, it's just time to really pray about education because it's changed in the past 100 years. I mean, we were talking earlier about how you talked with Peter about the new book out for students. I think it's called George, and that's for fourth graders now. Well, back 50 years ago, it was A Wrinkle in Time, and so obviously our curriculum is changing, and so we can be prepared for that. We can love on our teachers, love on our school board, and know that they really do want to help our students. But we really need to get involved. But in a way that is constructive, in a way that is encouraging, and in a way that is not from a place of fear, but from a place of love.
Rebecca, thanks for your insights. When we come back, we'll pray here on CBN News Sunday. Stick around and join us. We always like to finish with prayer on CBN News Sunday. Sue, will you lead us in praying for our schools, children, and parents, and then Rebecca?
Sure. Lord, we just lift up your name, Lord, and we thank you
that you've called us to be the light to this world, Lord. We lift up every student, every youth who's going to school. We lift up their teachers. We lift up the principals and school boards, Lord. And we just ask that you shine your light, Lord. And for all the parents and all those in the community, Lord, help us to go in to shine your light, to let people know that you are a God of love. We praise you.
Yes, Lord, and thank you so much for all you're doing in our school system already, Lord. And we just pray for encouragement and for your light to shine, like Sue said, Lord, just that we won't be afraid, that we won't be afraid of the years to come, but we will be excited about our children growing up in a world where they can be a light for you, Lord. And pray a blessing over the teachers and school boards that have some tough years coming up, God.
Amen. That's all the time we have for CBN News Sunday. You can watch the latest news anytime at cbnnews.com or follow us on Facebook and Twitter. Until next time, may God bless you and keep you.